I'm Aunt Kelly.
Got a race to me.
Got a race to her. And then race all the way.
Uncle Buck.
Matthew, you tear it up before you start. You're not going to get another one.
I can carry him down the road.
Yeah, go get the line.
Is that it?
No, you gotta go do
it.
You gotta get in line with the rest of the guys. Then you gotta run this way with your water balloon. Go down there with it.
You got short legs, so I don't know. Come on, Dakota, come down here.
Go with Sandy.
Put this on.
Go with Sandy. Sandy's got nothing. Hurry.
the unknown bag boy. Hey.
Instead of five raffles,
you buy for hot dogs.
Right, Cindy. Bobbing for French fries.
Recording, it says record. Yeah.
How many times do they go around?
100 times.
3 times.
3?
No,
300 times. Yeah. 300 times.
5 times.
Yay! Yeah.
Five.
Six.
Been around 5 times with this. Is this the one?
Get all them yonder.
There she is.
No, you just lay it down. And then catch
okay.
And get it.
What do you think for? Let's turn around. Same time.
Yay!
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Three times.
No, you're out of here. Put your head on.
All right, ready?
Kirk's burning something over there. All right, let's have some action.
Okay, say go.
Go.
Don't do it to me yet!
Matthew. Ryan, do you know who that's from? Do you know who that's from?
From me. It's from Papa.
Oh, cool. Ryan, be sure and say thank you.
Does it show you where the devil is?
Show you where the fossils are.
Does it show you where the devil is? Does it show you where Jesus lives?
Well,
does it show you where North Carolina is? Does it show you anything?
Whatever it is.
Everything in the world.
And even the devil, even the ground, even the leaves.
Ryan, show me when you open it.
Huh?
When you're through opening it, show me.
Say anything. It could be what you said.
It's not a Barbie doll.
Michelle, you want to record?
No, it's a model.
Oh, cool.
Now open this.
It's a model.
Open this.
Watch out, you cut it out. Knock it
off. Mom, you gotta move.
It's a box of checks. It's a box of what?
Checks.
Everybody's giving away the stuff.
Can you tell that's a D?
Some people are giving away the stuff.
Well, they don't even know what it is.
So a lot of people are giving them.
Somebody's bank is
My mom bought her checks. My mom bought him checks.
Box of checks. Right up a storm.
Checks?
Mommy, tell them not to give it away or tell anything.
I think you're a good job. Where's this one come from? You
already opened up the box.
You can go shopping.
You can buy what?
Then he can buy anything you
Sega,
want.
Genesis, car.
So you like my
gift
best?
Oh, cool.
What are those?
Those are Legos.
Let me
see it. I think that's Legos.
That's what he asked me for.
Yep. And then my mom says, are you going to give him your Game Boy?
Here, put it there. And you said, I don't think so, huh?
Uh-oh, now it's back to me, Legos.
More Legos?
It's spirals.
You never have too many Legos.
Open Chad.
Open mine.
Shit your brains out.
I think I know what it is.
I got it good.
Don't give away
something,
Chris. That's a power ring.
No, it ain't.
Is it a power ring?
It's really cool.
No, it ain't.
Yeah, you didn't want to tell anybody.
Well, that's from Chad. I like that paper.
It's a model.
It's a truck.
It's a model.
It's a snap tie.
Oh, cool.
Huh?
Chad, did you get
it's a snap tie.
No.
No.
Thank you.
My mom has.
Let me see.
Wait a minute, we need to know.
out of sight.
Look,
right
look,
the cake out here.
Show me it. Lord,
we'll be opening
the
these presents.
I get the whole envelope. Can I have the envelope?
Oh, blow.
The cake.
Sweet. Where?
In the envelope, she said there was money.
Favorite.
Let me see it, Ryan.
She said that on the envelope, there was money.
Thank
Grandma
you.
Grandma said that? Let's go.
Thank you. Yeah.
So this one's for you, Ryan.
Right. And here's one. I'm going to go play. Oh, I'm
going to
take them
off. Michelle must have got
it.
That it?
Can I go get my
I am Lord of this. generation of elementary children. He made it possible to create an advanced musical sound on these wooden and metal instruments. We will perform a piece composed by another music educator by the name of Zoltan Kodai, entitled The Viennese Musical Clock.
Hello, I'm Chris McPhee, student body president. We at Pinewood are very proud of our 4th and 5th grade beginning strings orchestra. They have been very dedicated to strings this year. We are looking forward to the performance featuring French folk songish Cool String Blues.
Thank you.
theatrical dance made up by the tapping of the feet. Some steps include brush, flap, shuffle, ball change, and crab roll. Tap dance became popular in 1828 when people noticed how slaves began to pick up their feet to dance. So sit back and enjoy watching Rachel Parker tap into Sing, Sing, Sing.
Everybody goes down. Like there's something you should know. Oh, baby, oh, oh, sing, sing. Wonderful performance, Intermediate Orchestra. Tonight, Davina Carnegie and Amanda Teller are celebrating America as they sing what has become a well-known American classic, God Bless the USA.
Thank you.
Jive Bunny.
The master mixes.
Megan. By the way, great job at the dance competition. Now we get to watch Casey Smith and Sarah Reese with their jazz gyms dance that they choreographed themselves. Great job, girls.
That light, I think, is real.
The light's messing it up?
Yeah.
You're not going to see it without it. Need to get in on it for a little bit. It's not acting up right now. It's spinning just fine. Can you see the black thing spinning?
No.
Can you see it now?
I can see it better, but not that great.
You just, you does not focus now. Unless you're too far.
Yeah, there it is.
Listen. Thump, 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 thump. It's not continuous. Okay, now we're gonna go to the chicken house and we're gonna record that. Let's go.
Thank you.
like to end our evening by first thanking all of the performers tonight. Would every performer stand? Give them a great round of applause.
Thank you. by Newt Gingrich in writing. And for him to come up at the last minute, at 7 p.m. the night before the bills to come to the floor, and for the first time in 18 months, attack them, and then to fax his material out to the talk show host all over the country that night, obviously indicated that he had a strategy. He was an effective propagandist.
I want to read to you now a paragraph from a letter that Newt Gingrich sent to all Republican members, advising them of the elements of this legislation.
The next day, Limbaugh began attacking the bill.
Some people have even called this hush rush too, because it is theorized that if you listen to me or watch this show or listen to any talk show host, and as a result of hearing what you hear are motivated to call Washington, that we could all be considered lobbyists, or you could be, and you'd have to report this. It's an effort to try to get people to shut up out of fear.
By 11 o'clock the next day, our telephones were ringing off the hook from these people calling in about this horrible grassroots provision that was going to somehow impede their ability to contact their congressman. It was totally false, but it was an appealing falsehood, and it worked.
The lobby bill died in the final days of the campaign.
I'll tell you what, you think liberalism isn't on its last legs, all you got to do is watch this campaign. Now look.
Every day during the campaign, Rush held court in his electronic clubhouse. He would explain to his people how the campaign was going, and his show told the party bosses what the people were thinking. He had become a unique political figure, a national precinct captain for the conservative movement and the Republican Party.
We'll be back with marching orders next.
And with 20 million listeners and a national TV audience, this was some precinct.
We're gonna go in, we're gonna conquer, and we ain't getting out. Now, if you want in on this mission, a crucial mission, be ready at dawn tomorrow. Dawn Tuesday. If you're not interested in this mission, get out of the way, because we're coming through.
And on Election Day, Rush's precinct did come through. Not one Republican incumbent lost a race.
This is truly a wildly historic night. I mean, this is just...
Welcome to the most important people in Washington.
Before the 104th Congress convened, the new Republican members gathered to plot their strategy to revolutionize Washington.
This is the greatest political story ever told, and you are now part of that story.
At a conference in Baltimore, the party elders were on hand to initiate the 73 incoming freshmen and to impart their political wisdom.
I urge you to act decisively and also quickly in this next 100 days and the next 200 days to reorient our government.
But the real center of gravity at the event was Rush Limbaugh, the guest of honor and the man everybody wanted to hear. To many of these fervent newcomers, Rush was the man who made their victory possible.
Hello, Steve Stagman. I'd be Jack Brooks.
Hey, how are you? It's great.
I'm Patty.
And this
Hi.
Is our, this
nice
is our wedding anniversary.
Is that right?
Yes.
No kidding.
I have a question for you.
Rush has 20 million listeners. I think Rush is, critics call him fanatical, but he's mainstream. The guys that are listening are mainstream. If you go out in the streets and the byways, and you go down in Oklahoma, you go down in Kansas, you go down in Illinois, they listen to Rush.
He's a provocateur. He is a agent provocateur of what I would call progressive conservatism. I don't think he's going to run for office. I don't think he's going to lead a football team. I don't think he's going to lead the country. But in many ways, he's leading public opinion. And Lincoln said you can accomplish anything you want if you've got public opinion behind you, and you can't get anything done without it.
Even in his moment of triumph, you couldn't help noticing that Rush seemed uncomfortable so close to his flock. He had taken the Limbaugh legacy far from Cape Girardeau, but he still seemed that uneasy boy who could solve his separateness only by reaching for a microphone.
You people in the press have got to understand something. This country is conservative. It has been for a long time. Get used to it. You tried to change it and you failed, and tonight proves it.
And now, at the height of his powers, Rush has already chosen his role in the new conservative era.
One of the questions I was asked as the reporters were peppering me was, do you think Newt will moderate his stance now that he's the Speaker of the House? And I said, better not.
He saw George Bush collapse completely because he said one thing and did something else. He broke a promise on taxes. And Rush believes that the last thing the Republicans need is for them to do that again. So he's going to be the enforcer. And he means it. You know, you're still friends, guys, but, you know, I'm gonna call it as I see it. And if you go south on me, you know, you get whacked too.
It would seem arrogant for a talk show host to threaten the Speaker of the House with a political whipping. But the constituents of Newt's new majority were Rush's people first. And Rush works the precinct every day.
Surveys show that people who listen to Rush Limbaugh have 45% cleaner and brighter wash. You're somebody special when you listen to Rush Limbaugh.
On the Excellence in Broadcasting Network, I am here, my friends, ensconced firmly and comfortably in the prestigious Attila the Hun chair.
Back in his studio, Rush is now getting more than 500 faxes a day. But now it's not just ditto heads and party leaders who want to reach him. Even totems of the established order, like Alan Greenspan, the chairman of the Federal Reserve Board, now offer Rush briefings.
He is probably better informed if he chooses to be in the morning than almost anyone in the country. Because everyone has decided what's most important to them and tried to communicate that to him by 10 o'clock in the morning. It's quite remarkable, which is why I think that's why I think he can sustain what he's doing for a lot longer. Because when you're on top of the world, everyone is aiming to influence you.
Rush Limbaugh sits at the center of the new politics. His enemies still denounce him, but now they're also trying to emulate him. They hope that a powerful liberal voice, perhaps a Mario Cuomo, will soon take the field to answer him. But it won't be easy, because Rush Limbaugh could not have been invented by politicians. He was a new voice who found his perfect moment, and only then did the politicians find him. Our new wired-up hyper-democracy promises the sound of many voices, the fury of competing ideas. What it has delivered, so far, is the sound and fury of this one uncontested voice.
Having more fun than a human being should be allowed to have. Rush Limbaugh, the majority maker and honorary member of the 104th House of Representatives.
Dear Frontline, I am so grateful for Frontline.
And now it's time for your letters. Our recent program, The Godfather of Cocaine, brought these viewer comments.
Dear Frontline, I was fascinated by your program on the late Colombian drug lord Pablo Escobar. Though the whole world knew him to be a vicious criminal, many Colombians you interviewed would speak only of his virtues as a family man, philanthropist, and so forth. What an elegant comment on the value relativism of our modern world. In 1995, you could capture the devil himself, and there would be plenty of friends, family members, and employees who would find some pretense to praise him. Paul Nauman, White River, South Dakota.
The story on Pablo Escobar lacked the resentment the vast majority of Colombians have on him and any other individuals that oversee the traffic of drugs all over the world. More interviews on the average Colombian layman should have showed the distaste and lack of support these individuals have in Colombia. The interviews should have been more balanced, reflecting various points of view. Certainly, the documentary was focused on Escobar, but there were, are, and will be drug godfathers, because there is no better international policy on the subject. Legalization may be the answer. It should be given a chance. Mauricio Londono, New Jersey.
Dear Frontline, while Colombia and the world at large are undoubtedly better off without Pablo Escobar, I found barbaric the DEA agents and Colombian law enforcement officials posing with his body as if they were on a big game hunt. The triumph Escobar's pursuers felt at the end of their long quest should have been tempered with a modicum of decorum, and the photos of their gloating should certainly have remained behind Frontline's cameras. Sincerely yours, Hester Fuller, Jamaica Plain, Massachusetts.
You can interact with Frontline by sending your comments by fax to 617-254-0243 by letter or home video to this address.
I know you liberals are tuning in. You got the lights out, you're cowered in the corner, and you don't want to admit to anybody that you're watching this. We know you're there. You're scared. I just want to leave you with this. We feel your pain.
Funding for Frontline is provided by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by annual financial support from viewers like you. Frontline is produced for the Documentary Consortium by WGBH Boston, which is solely responsible for its content. For video cassette information about this program, please call this toll-free number, 1-800-328-PBS1.
This is PBS.
If tomorrow never comes, will she know how much I loved her? The thunder rolls and the lightning strikes. Another love grows cold. The thunder rolls.
Sunday at 8, here on Channel 24.
Together again for the first time in 14 years, the Eagles.
Welcome to the Hotel California.
Their songs are like old friends. It just feels good to be around them. The Eagles in the spotlight. Right here.
Saturday at 10, here on Channel 24.
For one night, John Tesh is the entertainment. An electrifying event, an awe-inspiring setting, and a musical tribute to some of the world's greatest athletes like Nadia Comaneci and Bart Conner. Don't miss John Tesh live at Red Rocks with the Colorado Symphony Orchestra.
Saturday at 8, here on Channel 24.
WMFE is making a difference in Central Florida, and you can make a difference the next time you make your travel arrangements by using the WMFE Travel Service. The service is operated by travel professionals and offers a full line of vacation and business services. Every use of the travel service directly benefits WMFE, and that means more revenue to help provide you with the programming you want. Support WMFE when you make your next travel arrangements.
Bulimia. Anorexia, obesity. Does someone you love suffer from an eating disorder?
I would eat and then think, oh gosh, I better get rid of this.
Food is the most addicted substance that any of us have to deal with.
John Bradshaw helps you understand the deadly realities of eating disorders.
An addict is not hopeless, but an addict feels hopeless.
John Bradshaw on eating disorders.
Saturday afternoon, here on Channel 24.
What's so funny about you?
I said your money or your life.
I'm thinking it over.
I just.
I understand.
Jack Benny.
Good night, folks.
Comedy in Blue.
Wednesday at 10, here on Channel 24.
Ever wonder why Carousel isn't called an opera? Maybe if Richard Rodgers had called himself Ricardo Ruggiero. Anyway, Kathleen Battle and Thomas Hampson are going to sing not only Rodgers and Kern, but Mozart and Rossini as well. Next time on Live from Lincoln Center.
Wednesday at 8, here on Channel 24.
Channel 24, your vital resource for education and the arts.
Funding for this program has been provided by Farberware, creators of Farberware Millennium Neverstick Stainless Steel Cookware. For every chef, Farberware Millennium Neverstick Stainless Steel Cookware.
By ITT Sheraton, our world revolves around you. And by American Airlines, an airline dedicated to excellence. American Airlines, something special in the air. Southern cooking has two meanings for rising star chef Dave Danhai. At his restaurant Georgia in Los Angeles, you'll find Southern cooking in Southern California. And you can bet that he always has Georgia on his mind.
What I'm trying to get across at the restaurant is you can have Southern food, but still keep a health-conscious mind while you eat it. We pretty much omitted any ham in the whole restaurant, any pork in the whole restaurant, with the exception of the ribs and the pork chops. But we just try and keep it real low fat, low butter, where we can. And there's places that you don't want to skimp on the butter and the fat. But there are definitely places that you can go light and still have an extremely enjoyable meal with a health-conscious influence on it.
Dave Danhai has come to the Napa Valley to prepare a Southern-style late-afternoon jazz party for 10. The afternoon features a buffet of Southern favorites presented in a tantalizing decor that comes right out of the refrigerator.
One of the reasons I like to do the soft-shell crabs is that it's a fresh thing. They're only in season for a few months of the year, and when they come in, I like to do them as much as I can because there's so many things you can do with them. The etouffee is a very traditional, classic Southern dish, and it ties in really well with the soft shells. The flavors, again, just come together very well. Etouffee means smothered. They're not quite smothered, but it's almost like a stew. It is served as a soup a lot, but I choose to use it as a sauce and just kind of to expand on all the flavors that are in it because you're not eating so much at the same time as opposed to a soup. Okay, we're going to make a soft shell crabs with the crayfish etouffee. There's two reasons I like to make this. One would be it is a very traditional Southern dish, and two is because we get to use the freshest ingredients possible, especially with soft shells in season. Everything just, it really comes together in nice, fresh, healthy, good-for-you food.
For the crayfish and soft shell crab etouffee, the main ingredients are all-purpose flour, unsalted butter, onions, red bell peppers, garlic, jalapeno peppers, celery, Roma tomatoes, green onions, tomato paste, lemons, clam juice, Worcestershire sauce, cayenne pepper, parsley, oregano, thyme, salt, pepper, crayfish, and soft-shell crabs. Chef Dan Hai begins by melting 3/4 cup unsalted butter in a saucepan. He finely dices 2 large onions, and finely dices 6 celery stalks. To the melted butter, he stirs in 1/2 cup all-purpose flour and cooks over low heat to make a dark brown roux. Next, he finely dices 2 seeded red bell peppers. Seeds and dices 4 jalapeno peppers. And minces 3 tablespoons of garlic. He pours the browned roux into a large, heavy-bottom saucepan. Adds the onions, celery, red bell peppers, jalapeno peppers, and garlic, and cooks for 10 minutes, stirring often. Next, he chops 2 cups of green onions, dices 4 cups ripe Roma tomatoes, and adds the tomatoes to the saucepan. He continues to stir and cook for an additional 10 minutes. Next, he chops 1/2 cup parsley, chops 1 tablespoon fresh thyme, and chops 1 tablespoon fresh oregano. To the saute pan, he then adds 4 cups clam juice, 4 teaspoons tomato paste, 4 teaspoons Worcestershire sauce, and the juice of 2 lemons. The liquid is brought to a boil and then allowed to simmer for 15 to 20 minutes. The parsley, thyme, oregano, and green onions are added, along with salt and pepper. And 2 teaspoons cayenne pepper. He continues to cook until the mixture has thickened and most of the water has evaporated. Next, Chef Dan Hai removes the meat from 48 crayfish tails. The crayfish are cooked by boiling in salted water for 5 minutes. Crayfish tails are added to the etouffee, and the pan is removed from the heat and reserved. After removing the eyes, gills, and front half of 20 soft-shell crabs, he dips each one in a bowl of all-purpose flour seasoned with salt and pepper. crab is sautéed in butter over high heat, turning once for approximately 3 to 4 minutes per side, or until crispy. A splash of white wine is added to the sauté pan for each crab. To present the dish, Chef Danhai ladles a bed of the étouffée onto a large serving platter. Adds the soft shell crabs and smothers them with more étouffée.
With the soft shell crabs, I would go with the Chardonnay. It goes very well with. We do use it in the recipe, in the sautéing of the crabs themselves. I'm originally from New York, moved out here when I was 10, started working not too much longer after that, and went back to New York for 1 year to work up in the Catskills. I started in the business at like the neighborhood pizza place and went on to the Chart House and just snowballed from there, kept working at it, found that I really had a big passion for working with food and marriage of flavors and everything, and just kept doing it and still doing it. As far as formal training for me, I did not go to culinary school. I'd moved to upstate New York meaning to go to the Culinary Institute, and I was fresh out of high school, 2 weeks out of high school, and I got there and I decided that it doesn't make sense to go spend all this money to go to school, for me at least, when I could have just worked and learned from that. So what I did is I had just worked about 25, 30 restaurants on just for free. I had my one job that paid for my rent, and the rest was just to go out and learn what I can, try and get under the great chefs there. And I learned a lot. That was, I think, for me, that was better than any school that I could have gone to. I've worked with a lot of great chefs, very thankful for the chefs that I have worked with. And it's still an ongoing thing. So as far as mentors go, I wouldn't want to single any one person out, but I have worked with a lot of great people. The biggest influence in my food that I try and put forth would be freshness. I am a fanatic for fresh food. The fresher, the better. I try and stay with the seasons as far as the menus go and what I'm doing. Leaves a lot of room to play with, and plus, again, you're getting the freshest product available. When I first got to Georgia, the menu was already pre-existing. They'd been open for 2 months at that point. So what I had done is I completely revised all the recipes that were there, revised the menu a little bit, and just tweaked it here and there. And now we've gotten it to a point where people are pretty happy with every single menu item we have on there. They're pretty much almost all signature items. And we just try and do specials to go with the seasons. And again, we will change the menu when we feel necessary, but slight revisions. When you first walk into Georgia, it's a gorgeous room. The walls have hand-painted palm trees and the sconces for the lights. It's a gorgeous room. When you walk in, you almost feel as if you're down south, except you're on Melrose in L.A. Dimly lit, but not to the point of too dark. You're catered to from the beginning of your as soon as you walk in the front gate until you leave. And to have people leave and see the smiles on their face, if they happen to see me out on the floor and, hey, that was a great meal, it makes it all worth it. I know that we've all got our goal. We hit somebody else and they're gonna go tell somebody. As far as the celebrity chef stuff goes, I never got into this with the intention of becoming famous, or even the yearning or the want to become famous. I do this because I have the passion for the food and cooking with food. If the fame was gone tomorrow, not that the fame is here, but if it was gone tomorrow, it wouldn't faze me. As long as I can keep cooking and people keep loving the food, that's all that matters to me. Eventually, I'd like to open my own restaurant. I'm in no rush. I've seen way too many restaurants come and go. It's a quick way to lose a lot of money. Right now, I'm just putting my theme together, of what I want to do and the location I'd like to do it. And I'm almost there, but I'm in no rush. I can wait. You know, I'm still young, so I can wait whatever it takes. Okay, I'm going to make a peach cobbler. This is one of the signature items of the restaurant. People will come from all around just to taste a peach cobbler. If you love peaches, you'll love this cobbler.
To prepare this recipe, you will need cinnamon, nutmeg, ground ginger, salt, flour, peaches, oranges, lemons, granulated sugar, brown sugar, butter, vanilla, eggs, and baking powder.
Our peach cobbler has probably become our signature item at the restaurant. People do talk about it all around town and come specifically for the cobbler. Very traditional southern dessert. That is something that personally we didn't want to throw too many complex things into. It's a very plain and simple dessert. It's just the peaches, you know, regular sugar, brown sugar, ginger, nutmeg, cinnamon, vanilla, butter, and then the topping. It's great whether it's a hot day or a cool day. It can be eaten at any time.
Chef Dan Hai begins by washing and blanching 5.5 pounds of fresh peaches. He peels and slices each peach into segments. To the peaches, he adds 1/2 teaspoon ground ginger, 1.5 teaspoons nutmeg, 1/2 teaspoon cinnamon, 1/2 teaspoons. Next, he adds 1.5 cups granulated sugar, 1 cup lightly packed brown sugar, 1 tablespoon flour, 1/2 teaspoon salt, 1/2 teaspoon lemon juice, 1 tablespoon orange juice. The peaches are then mixed to coat them with the mixture. Then strained and reserved. To make the topping for the cobbler, Chef Dan Hai combines in a mixing bowl 2 cups flour, 1.5 cups sugar, and 1 tablespoon baking powder. Scrambles 3 eggs and slowly adds them to the dry ingredients, mixing until the pastry is well blended. Next, Chef Dan Hai pours the drained peach liquid into a pitcher. Adds 1 tablespoon vanilla extract and 3 tablespoons melted butter. Individual ramekins are placed in a baking pan and filled with the peach segments. Peach liquid is poured into each one. Covered with the pastry topping, and drizzled with melted butter. Are then placed in a 325-degree oven for approximately 1 hour, or until the topping turns a golden brown. A final topping of ice cream completes this typical Southern treat.
For the peach cobbler, I would go with the Fumé Blanc. The fruity overtones really go well with the peaches, and they complement each other very well.
Glassware has had a very interesting history also, and the fact that everything from just a very simple tumbler, and in the olden days it was probably an earthenware tumbler. My grandfather preferred drinking his wine, red or white, whatever, just from a regular, they call it kind of an old tumbler. Clear glass, hold about 6 or 8 ounces. The traditional stemware was created so that you could enjoy wine completely. Wine is not just a beverage to drink and not enjoy with all of your senses. You can swirl the glass, look at the color and the way the light reflects off the different red and white wines. Also, swirling the glass is very interesting because it releases the aromatics of the wine. It enhances them. Try this sometime. It's a lot of fun. Pick a glass up, move it very, very gently, and just smell it. Take that same glass, swirl it around, smell it again. The nose or the aromatics of that wine is enhanced maybe tenfold by the swirling. White wine glasses are generally a little narrower because they don't have as much of the nuance of aroma to release. They generally have more fruit that jumps out of the glass readily. And you want the white wines to be centered more in the middle of your tongue for the wonderful crisp acid finish. The red wines, you need to swirl a little more to release flavor, so they're a larger bowl, about 12 ounces, and shaped in a rounder condition. And as you swirl it, the aromatics fill that bowl and are kind of trapped in there. So then when you smell it, it's very intense. Also, the lip being wider, as you swallow, it washes your tongue with the red wine rather than directing it more towards the center of the tongue as most of the white wine glasses. And it's really become a lot of fun in the toasting. When you clank the glasses together or cling them together, the wonderful sounds that they make, it's really kind of a celebration, whether it's on Wednesday night, dinner for two, or at a party for friends.
Southern hospitality is in evidence at this late afternoon jazz party. The buffet is set so that the guests can mill around the table informally, enjoying the food and each other's company. The object is to create a cascade of vegetables that flows from the pot of flowers to the buffet platters. Start by creating different levels on the table, which can be done using common household objects. The number of risers depends on the number of dishes that will be served. Drape the tablecloth over each riser and bunch the excess fabric around each level to cloud the area. Colorful platters and bowls are then placed on the risers. Put ferns, vegetables, and fruits around the bowls to create a cascading effect. Buffet table is set with silverware, stemware, and china, ready for eager and appreciative guests. Recipes, wine, and decorating tips from today's program are in the companion book to America's Rising Star Chefs, available by calling 1-800-554-CHEF now. With over 120 recipes, plus 13 great party ideas and useful information on wine, this beautiful book will help you to be a star in your own home. To order your copy of Robert Mondavi Presents Cooking and Entertaining with America's Rising Star Chefs, call 1-800-554-CHEF now, and please have your credit card ready. Funding for America's Rising Star Chefs is provided by American Airlines, an airline dedicated to excellence. Something special in the air. By ITT Sheraton. Our world revolves around you.
By Farberware. Creators of Farberware Millennium Neverstick Stainless Steel Cookware. For every chef. Farberware Millennium Neverstick Stainless Steel Cookware.
John Tesh is the entertainment. An electrifying event. An awe-inspiring setting. And a musical tribute to some of the world's greatest athletes, like Nadia Comaneci and Bart Conner. Don't miss John Tesh, live at Red Rocks with the Colorado Symphony Orchestra.
Saturday at 8, here on Channel 24.
Hello, I'm Jackie Brockington. Join me as host of Assignment here on Channel 24, a weekly half-hour series that looks into the inner workings of local government and service agencies, the challenges they face, and what it means to you. So, mark your calendars that you'll have an assignment Thursdays at 8:30 here on Channel 24.
What's so funny about you?
I said your money or your life.
I'm thinking it over.
I
understand.
Jack Benny.
Good night, folks.
Comedy in Blue.
Wednesday at 10, here on Channel 24.
Ever wonder why Carousel isn't called an opera? Maybe if Richard Rodgers had called himself Ricardo Ruggiero. Anyway, Kathleen Battle and Thomas Hampson are going to sing not only Rodgers and Kern, but Mozart and Rossini as well, next time on Live from Lincoln Center.
Wednesday at 8, here on Channel 24.
Some people hustle pool, some people hustle cars. But have you ever heard about the man who hustles stars? Jack Horkheimer, star hustler, director of the Miami Space Transit Planetarium.
Our episode for this week, Monday, February 27th through Sunday, March 5th, is A Journey to Orion's Belt. Greetings, greetings, fellow stargazers. And in this episode, we're going to talk about one of the favorite and most well-known constellations in winter skies, Orion, the Mighty Hunter, which is perhaps the easiest of all constellations to find. Even easier for most people than the Big Dipper because of the three stars which make up Orion's belt. Let me show you. Okay, we're facing due south any night in February between the hours of 7 and 9 p.m., where you will easily spot three stars equally spaced in a row. The only three such equally spaced stars visible to the naked eye, I might add. And these stars form the belt of the great giant Western civilization calls Orion the Mighty Hunter. Now, below the belt, we see two bright stars for his knees, and above the belt, two bright stars for his shoulders. Now, the three belt stars are, as you regular viewers know, my favorite stars of all to pronounce, because they sound so much like they came right out of American Indian folklore, although they are indeed Arabic in origin. From left to right, the three belt stars are Al-Nutak, Al-Nilam, and Mintaka. I mean, doesn't that sound American Indian? Al-Nutak, Al-Nilam, Mintaka. At any rate, on Midian night as a youngster, I wish that I could just momentarily shut off gravity with a cosmic switch and fly faster than the speed of light to visit these three stars in the giant's belt. Then later, when I really got serious about the science of astronomy, I discovered that in factual imagination, I could. So let me take you on an imaginary but factually scientific journey to these three marvelous stars, of which Lord Tennyson once wrote, "Those three stars of the eerie giant's zone that glitter burnished by the frosty dark." Our first stop, our own sun, which is a very average yellow star with a relatively cool surface temperature of 10,000 degrees Fahrenheit and a rather meager diameter, slightly less than 1 million miles. Then, from our sun, let's fly on the wings of the gods just to the outskirts of the middle star of Orion's belt, Al-Nilam, which is 1,200 light years away and burns a blue-hot 51,000 degrees Fahrenheit and makes our sun puny by comparison, because we could line 16 suns up across its middle. Al-Nutak, on the other hand, is 100 light years farther away, being 1,300 light years distant. And although only 9 times the diameter of our sun, it burns an even hotter blue 53,000 degrees Fahrenheit. The longest journey, though, is to Mintaka, more than twice the distance from Earth as Al-Nilam or Al-Nutak, being 2,400 light years away and burning a bit cooler at 45,000 degrees Fahrenheit. And smaller, only 6.5 times the size of our sun. Even so, if these three stars could be lined up side by side with our sun, their sizes and temperatures would make our sun seem insignificant. Almond.